What's going on, guys? So it is Saturday now, and it's not over yet. I got some more traveling to do. I'm about to head out to Massachusetts, to where the Big E usually is, to go check out Ammo Fight League. We just had Bill Vigil in studio the other night down here. Drove like an hour and a half to come here for our interview, which was such a blessing. And now I'm about to hit the road. But first, before I do that, let me tell you guys that the new video is up where I did the vlog, which you guys are watching a vlog right now. I did the vlog for Bellator 207, which I'm calling a fight companion, just so people like kind of understand what it is, but really it's not a fight companion. I'm not Joe Rogan. I am doing this for you guys to see what it's like behind the scenes for media members, bring through the day, and also give you some of the best highlights of the night and how we reacted on Press Row. And I really enjoy doing this. I've had some amazing feedback from the videos already, and I'm having a lot of fun vlogging. I think this is the new venture here for the YouTube channel. I think this is gonna really help the YouTube channel as well. I've been trying to figure it out because the podcast is doing phenomenal on iTunes, Podbean, and you know, a couple thousand downloads a month. So where am I missing on YouTube? Well, figured it out. I think I figured it out. So we're gonna see how this goes. Hope you guys are enjoying the vlogs. Probably rambling on a little bit too long. So let's hit the road. So it looks like we made it. Finally here. Got a little confused because like I pulled into the address where it said it was, and I had to message Iggy and ask her. I was like, yo, I think I'm here. Oh no. I did pull in here originally too, which is funny. Hey guys, where are the fights at? Alright, cool. Thank you. We made it. We're here. Time to rip. The main event actually is off. I just tweeted it out to everybody. Apparently Isaac twisted his ankle, and it is apparently the size of a watermelon right now. Not a good scene. I'm sure they tried to save the card. The commission had to call it off. It went down earlier on today when they were doing warm-ups inside here at the Big E Dome. So very upsetting, but there's still a lot of really great cards. A lot of great fights here tonight. Looking forward to it, but it's always a big punch to the gut when something like that happens. That's the world of MMA, though. That's the world. It's not like you're on a baseball team and your first baseman or your pitcher pulls his ankle. Game's not off. But in MMA, something like that happens. There's really not much that you can do. It's out of your control. So the night will go on. And I do not know if they will be giving the title now to John Manley. We're going to find out. I'll keep you guys posted. Just getting the TKO finish here. W back home. 203. Justin Sumter in this corner. You came in here before you even had the fight. I was outside just like trying to get my head around what happened in the main event, falling off, and your family was actually out there.
Yeah.
And they kind of hinted towards it. They're like, man, if he wins tonight, he's gonna move on to pro. And before we talk about that, man, this was a big fight. I had Bill Vigil come to the studio. He was talking, I brought you up. I was like, man, that's the one fight I'm really excited to see. And then here you are in the rematch. How excited were you for tonight? Because there was a lot of shit talking going, not shit talking, just
yeah.
You guys
confidence.
Know what you're doing. Confidence. You know what I mean? So what were your thoughts coming in here tonight?
I was honestly excited. I knew he was game. I mean, he beat my buddy Maddie, and Maddie's been training for a really long time. And he was my first fight, and he was extremely, extremely tough to fight. And he's very well-rounded, especially at the amateur level. know what I mean? So I knew he was gonna be tough, but at the end of the day, my skill set is just above everybody else, amateur, even at the pro level. I'm the top dog in New England, so it's really that simple.
And the really funny part is when I was talking to your family outside, we were looking up Tapology, and they're asking about your opponent, and you know how Tapology has all the rankings.
Yep.
I looked at you, man, you're number one in New England, number two in like the Northeast, man. So what was the decision to go pro? Was that your coaches? Was that you?
100% my coaches. I wouldn't make that decision. So I'm only 19.
Yeah, so you're a young guy.
I wouldn't make that decision on myself. But, you know what I mean, I think I'm built for the pro level. You see me in there. You watch guys like Khabib, GSP. You know what I mean? I'm turning around, longer rounds, elbows. I'm going to be a different animal. Like, I say what I want about not finishing. I haven't even lost a round. I don't see, you could watch the fights again. I don't think I've lost a minute.
You haven't lost fights. He's saying, like, pretty much, guys, he literally, well, not pretty much, literally has not lost a round his entire amateur career. What are you set on? Because there's a lot of excitement for you over at Cage Titans, I know. Ammo having some great events here, but where are you thinking about making your pro debut?
I think Cage Titans is the way. I like Bill Vigil a lot, but I just think... Paul Vera, man, we have a really good relationship. He's been been putting on fights for my gym for a really long time. So I think, you mean, they're streamed on Flow Combat. They're a great feeder program. We're starting to get guys in the UFC. So I think I don't think anywhere really matters. I think I'm a top prospect, so wherever I can get a pro fight, I'll be able to build my career. But I think Paul Vera is the right move.
One thing I really enjoyed seeing tonight was at the end of the fight, I know that you guys put a lot of promotion into it to get people to come here. I mean, half the place even left as soon as you guys walked out. But listen, you guys hugged it out right at the end. Was that something that you knew was going to happen?
Yeah, I mean, there was nothing. There was no serious animosity, you know what I mean? I've been competing my whole life. Like, you know, when I started training, I was 12. I know how to compete. At the end of the day, you put me under the lights, I know how to compete. And when it's all said and done, there's nothing but respect. And he's a tough dude, man. Like, especially for my amateur career. He didn't have many fights, but he beat, when I say my buddy Matty, I think his, you mean, another top. He's only had one fight, but he's got a lot of life situation. I'm telling you, he's better than any 125 I faced. Then David beat him. You know what I mean? So I knew David, any of the dudes I faced, David would beat, and I know that. You know what I mean? So I knew he was gonna be the toughest matchup, and hey, you know what I mean? Not a round loss, not a minute loss.
So obviously we got the belt. Let's check out this belt, man. You got a couple of belts right here.
Yeah, man. Like, I got a little bit of collection going on now.
Throw that shit over your shoulders. We got some nice stuff going on here. Yeah. Did you get to talk to your opponent backstage now?
Yeah. We talked a little bit. You know what I mean? He was cool, and just nothing to respect. You know what I'm saying? Nothing. This is the fight game. You know what I mean? Like, can't take things personal at the end of the day, you know what I mean? We both step out there from a sold-out crowd and we fight. You know, if you let things get personal, you're not meant for this game. You know what I'm saying?
Gotta ask you this too. Last night, did you catch Mikey Kimbel's performance, man?
Yeah, I did.
What'd you think about that? 6-second KO.
You're insane, you know, but that's sport, you know what I'm saying? It takes 1 second, you poke, bang, right hand, fight's over.
Second round. Back to his feet. Probably the best round of the night right there. That was great. Back and forth action. First round. Melon comes out with a somersault kick and then gets taken down. It wasn't that exciting, but second round, wow. UFC caliber round. Absolute madness here. Ammo, Bradley Seastad, and David Pacino. Literally Matt Hamill style. Slam to the back. Bradley Seastad went down and out. David, you know, getting the W. All right, guys, so we got Carlton Little here who headed off the main card here at Ammo Fight League 5, and what a way to start it off, man. I'm doing the video vlog, and I was like, that was UFC caliber fight right there. Obviously, it ended in the first round, back and forth. What were you expecting coming out? Were you expecting it to end in the first round, or what were your thoughts?
Oh, man. Honestly, he did what I thought he was going to do, which was come out and wrestle. You know, a lot of times people think they're strikers, and I get in there and show them who the real striker is. Just not to take anything from him. You know, he's a big dude, powerful dude, but I knew he was going to want to wrestle. I didn't expect to end up on top. That was the twist.
But what about that somersault kick that he threw?
Oh, man, that threw me off because I was like, what is this big guy doing? You know, like, is this what we doing today? I didn't train for that, man. I was training for him to come in and try to bully me and wrestle me. When he did that, I kind of was like, all right, so we're going to play that game today. You know, that plays into my strength with striking. So if he wanted to strike, I knew I had him, you know. I just thought he was going to try to grind me, which he did, but luckily we fell down and I was on top. And I'm not a big guy, but I'm pretty strong. So when I got on top, I knew I was going to keep him there and just kind of piece him up a little bit.
So obviously, man, that was a huge win. What was going through your mind in the second before it was called off?
How many of these uppercuts is he going to eat before he goes down? You know, I mean, I saw blood and like a shark, man. I just went in for the kill, you know. I didn't want to give him a chance to, you know, throw a lucky punch and catch me on the chin or anything like that. Or I don't want to take it to the next round. You know, I want to finish it in when I saw it. So I was like, just go. Just let it all, you know, leave it in the cage. And I did. And he went down and the ref jumped in. And the rest is history, man. I got that win. Came out with the boss and got that win.
When he did land a couple of strikes, were you surprised with his power or was it what you were expecting?
He was strong, dude. You know, I just made sure I was covering myself up. I didn't want to catch anything flush.
So, man, you got this, like, southern draw. Where are you from originally?
Originally, I tell people this all the time. Memphis raised, Texas made. So I'm from Memphis, Tennessee, and I moved to Texas about 5 years ago.
So coming up to this neck of the woods, man, is this where you started mixed martial arts, or did you come in, you know, young kid, doing wrestling, football, and all that? Were you always active, or?
My background is football. So, like, I played college football, University of Memphis.
Oh, hell yeah.
You know, I did martial arts as a, you know, in adolescence.
Like, let me stop you right there. What's the biggest difference between getting ready for a football game and training between football and mixed martial arts? What's the biggest difference?
The conditioning. Like, football shape is not mixed martial arts shape. Because, you know, in football, you know, plays on average last about 4 or 5 seconds. Like, you're in there for 5 minutes. And you're constantly moving. You're constantly doing things, you know. And, you know, you look at the clock, you think 3 minutes went by. It's only a minute has went by, man. It mentally messes with you. So the conditioning aspect, like, don't come in here thinking because you're in shape for football or any other sport, you're going to be successful in MMA. It's a different monster.
So how many fights do you want to have before the end of 2018 here? We have, like, what, 2 months away?
2 months away. I actually got fights lined up. So I'm 7-6 right now. If things play out my way, I got a chance to end the year at 10-6.
So listen, ammo, reality fighting, Cage Titans, where are you going to be next? Where are we going to see you?
In November, I'm going to be at Shamrock FC.
Oh, Shamrock. Yeah. I think they even had an event tonight. Shout out to those guys.
I have...
Because you're from that area, so, like, that makes kinda sense.
Right. If I do well on that one, I'll be back there in December. I actually have one October 27th, Dominion Warrior in Texas.
So, listen, before we end this interview, man, what did you learn the most through this fight camp, and now that it's all said and done with, what did you learn through all this?
These boys are pretty big up here. And it's cold. I was not used to the weather. I'm going to tell you something that's off subject. I've never heard so many people honk horns when I came up here. Like, everybody's honk. Like, oh my God, nobody's friendly. But
that's what a lot of people say. It's like down south, a lot of people are really friendly. Yeah. Up here, really uptight.
I'm like, whoa, give me a second, buddy. You know, but it's cool. I get it's a different culture. I like it, man. It's been fun since I've been here. And I know they told me they're going to do another in March. I'd love to come back, man, and put on another show.
What gym are you at? Where do you train?
I train at a couple of gyms in Texas. So Felix MMA, you know, sometimes I cross train at Fortis or whatever. So a few different gyms in Texas.
So did you get to talk to your opponent after the fights? Did you guys catch up at all?
Yeah, we talked before. I mean, I like Josh. Josh is a cool dude. We talked after. Actually, you know, as I fight guys that are older, like my age, it's not so much of that animosity. You know, we can sit down and talk, have a drink afterwards. You know what I'm saying? It's these young guys that are like, oh, you know what I'm saying? So Josh is a good guy, man. I like him. I hope he doesn't hang it up. He said he's trying to get one again in November. Man, keep going, man. This is not a loss. It's a lesson.
I love it, man. And I see that you're cage side right now. This is the last question. I see your cage side right now with, what is that, your wife?
No, just friend.
Oh, just a friend?
Yeah.
What were they thinking? Because it's really hard for families to come and watch somebody that they love get punched in the face. How do they react to it, you think? Especially the heavyweights, man. Right, that's got to be nerve-wracking.
I mean, just as long as I go in there and move around, that's the main thing. Like, whenever I get flat-footed with the big guys, that's when, you know, she starts wearing and people start wearing or whatever. But when I go in there and move around and use my movement, pick my shots, get in and get out, and don't get into a slow fest, I'm good. I'll do well. It's only when I stand toe-to-toe and try to bang with the big boys. Because I'm really naturally not a heavyweight. I'm 205. So, you know, he had me by about 20 pounds today, but it's all good, man. I had fun. I'm going to have fun. clean for me, Batman. I want to come out and put on a show for you guys.
There we go. Carlton Little. Not so little, Carlton Little. How about that? There you go, guys. Guys, we got Eddy George, CT Local, represent 203, training with Nick Newell, Justin Sumner. I love walking through here just because it's like Batman.
That's it.
Like you walk through and the lights come on one at a time. But honestly, man, first round, you got the TKO finish, came out very aggressive. What was going through your mind before you even had the fight backstage? How did you see this fight going down? Was it exactly what you expected? What was different, if anything?
I expected to just go out there and put on a good performance. I didn't really have like a round or an exact like knockout punch. I just wanted to go out there. My boy Mike Kimbel did his thing last night, so I was like, oh, I want to fall behind that.
Were you there? Were you there for Bellator last night?
Nah, I wasn't. I didn't make it in time. After I got done with the weigh-ins and ate, I missed Mike's fight, and I was like, I'm not going to go.
Coach Nick was busting my balls all night because I got my credentials. They're like, yeah, you got to wait a second. Your coach just looks at me and goes, he can wait.
That's
so
it.
I was like, Nick, come on, man.
Yeah, he's a ball breaker, bro.
And then you also got Justin, man. So, like, just the energy at that gym. Like, you guys are all training towards, you know, the number one goal to get a first round finish. How does it feel right now?
It feels good, man. Like, to be honest, when I was in the back warming up, I just kept on telling myself it's just like a sparring session. It's not any different. And I just went out there with the attitude this time, and that's what I did. My eyes were good. I saw everything for the most part. I mean, with always, you know.
You were first to strike the entire time.
Was I?
Yeah, you were the first one to strike. At least that's what I wrote down here. But then he came out with like a couple of leg kicks there. Did that kind of throw you off at all? Or you expecting him to like throw the kicks?
I was expecting that. I didn't know a lot about him. I took this fight short notice and went up a weight class. But from what I knew, was he was a Muay Thai guy and he liked to throw naked kicks. So I was expecting that. And just the game plan was if he threw a naked kick, try to come down the pipe with something, put it in his face, double up the jabs as much as possible. The clinch wasn't really something we worked on. It's just it fell into my hands and I have a strong clinch game already. I don't get to work that often. But it just worked out, you know, it just fell into place with the knockout, with the TKO. You know.
So, man, obviously, it's getting towards the end of 2018. Yeah. Do you see yourself fighting again before the end of the year?
Yeah, I already have a fight lined up for November 3rd.
November 3rd, what promotion? Cage Titans?
Yes, sir.
Man, I love Cage Titans, like the vibe of it. I mean, I love Ammo, I love all the regional promotions, but there's something about Cage Titans where it's like...
Paul Bear's a good dude, bro. And that venue is just how...
I love it. Like, it's like Gangs of New York style. Like, I can't even explain it. It's just like the energy is just so on point. It's so real. It's like what you see when you're a kid watching like MMA underground movies and stuff like that. Just has that energy. So obviously, it's been a huge week for... Connecticut, man. Mike Kimbel, what were your thoughts on his fight last night?
Wow, that was impressive, man. I was, as soon as I left, I went to my after weighing meals. Oh,
shit. No, you go ahead, keep on.
After my weighing meals, is always I go to Texas Roadhouse. So as soon as I left Texas Roadhouse, I put on Bellator.com. Boom, I pulled up right when he came out. I was like, oh, shit, perfect.
Right
on time. I seen the knock. I was like, whoo, that was quick.
Last circle.
That was quick. But no, it's very impressive, man. He puts in a lot of work. He's a guy that comes to FA a lot and trains at the gym. I've sparred with him many times, grappled him many times. He's a good teammate. I look at him as a teammate. He's a good fighter. He has a big future in Bellator, I feel.
Man, I've heard a lot about you throughout the years, obviously, training right down the road from me with Nick, with Justin. What other guys you got at the gym that we should keep our eyes out for? Because there's some big names there.
Oh, man. We have a lot of people, man. Nick Quatrock, he has a karate background. Black belt in karate. He's been doing it since he was a little kid. He actually has a fight in New York coming up in like 2 weeks. I think it's the 27th or 28th of October. He's really good. Got my boy Coley, who just started training not too long ago at our gym. Very good Muay Thai. He's gonna be fighting this year. Got a lot of guys, man. And you know, some people just want to go there and train, and they don't want to fight, but they know how to throw the hands, which is, you know, it helps me out. Doesn't matter if you want to fight or not, as long as you're a good partner, that's all that matters. So we got a lot of people there.
Who do you got here tonight? Like, who came out here to watch you fight? Because there's people all over the place between Bellator and everywhere. How many, you know, people came out to see you fight tonight?
Oh man, I had like 25 people. I sold 25 tickets. I had like
Which is definitely decent, considering, yeah, you know, we're not in Connecticut.
I'm not from Connecticut in general. I'm from South Carolina. I've been here for 4 years. I've been training with Nick Newell for a year and a half. But
how'd you find Nick then? How did you come across Nick, and what made you feel like that was the right spot for you?
I did my research, man. I YouTubed everybody around in the surrounding area before Nick opened his gym. I didn't like what I saw, and then I just so happened to do another search years later. And then I found Nick, and I was like, yo, this is the guy. I walked in. He's like, you want to do a free trial? I said, no, here's my money. I want to be a fighter. I started training that day.
This should be a question I should ask Nick myself, and he knows I'm going to ask him when I see him. Well, for you personally, what would you like to see Nick do next?
I'd like to see Nick get another fight. I feel he needs one more fight, and then he's in the UFC. He's a top-level fighter. He's high caliber. His striking's unorthodox. He's next level, and for anybody to not see that, respect that, they're a fool, and it will be shown soon enough. One more fight, and he's 100% in the UFC.
Here's the thing with, this is the last thing I'm going to say, here's the thing with Nick fighting on Dana White's Tuesday Night Contender Series. I was just like, I didn't think that was the right spot for him. I thought he deserved a spot, at least on the prelims to show what he's about, not in like a room, like, Contender Series, like you fighting out here pretty much, it's like a little awkward, there's no fans, it's friends and family.
Yeah, I was a little different. It was kind of awkward. I feel with the Contender Series, his opponent, they picked his kryptonite. Someone that was... I apologize.
No, you're good. 10 seconds.
Yeah, yeah, they picked his kryptonite, and he was winning the strike, and the guy obviously didn't want to strike with him, so he just held him on the ground. He didn't do anything from the bottom. He rode a wrist, stayed on his hip, didn't set up any ground and pound whatsoever, and obviously Dana White wasn't impressed with it. That's why he didn't get the contract. But Nick did everything he could with, you know, the worst style matchup that he could have had. And like I said, one more fight, he's going to win the next fight, and then he's going to be right in the UFC. No doubt about it.
Last question, just to catch up on facts. Who is your next fight against in November?
Ah, man.
Know his name?
To be honest, man, people, I don't want to make no one look bad, but I got switch-ups all the time. So yeah. I probably have like 2-3 people back out. But it's going to be at 155. I'm tired of fighting up. I'm tired of fighting the catch weights. Like, I'm a 155er, and that's what it is. Like,
you think they should open a 165-pound division?
I mean, they can. Like, a lot of people cry about it, and they say 165.
All right.
Yeah, open it. Why not?
All right, guys. Eddy George, first round TKO, man. Have a great night. Thank you so much for joining me.
Thanks,
I got to get you in studio since you're so close. So next time, guys, maybe we'll see him in Pure Evil MMA studio. Eddy George. Carlton Almeida, Rodrigo Almeida beating Seth Baszler here in the main event. AMA fight. Lights are on. We are ready to get out of here. Brian Miner in the cage. Thank you.